Can you guys believe that it's already been over 3 years since I quit my 9-to-5 to start a YouTube channel? Now, I quit my 9-to-5 back in 2018, and fast forward to today, so much has changed. For instance, the YouTube channel has gone from zero to almost 500,000. I've been able to build this business to the multiple seven figures and help over 5,000 people use social media, sign their own clients. You know, it's been such a wild ride, and I wanna let you guys know that all of this started because of this one video. Now, for those of you who are familiar with my channel, you obviously know that I have this viral video about Instagram here that has over 6 million views. But before this video, I actually did this video right here where I shared my story of why I decided to leave my 9-to-5. And although this video doesn't have nearly as many views as this one, this is actually the video that really set me up for success and really changed the trajectory of my career. Because once I posted this video, I had people messaging me wanting to be a client or wanting coaching. And that's kind of how my business really even started. And so today's video is gonna be me reacting to this one. I actually haven't watched this video in a long time, and I don't even remember what I said in that video. And so I think that it'd be a really great opportunity for me to just, you know, take a blast from the past and watch that video again and see if any of my thoughts have changed since quitting my 9-to-5. And my advice to you guys when it comes to carving your own path, starting a business, or even just taking a leap of faith and taking a bet on yourself. And so if you're interested in seeing me react to this video for the first time in a long time, then keep on watching. So here's a little tip for you guys before we start, especially if you are an aspiring content creator, is when you are creating a video on a topic that's really competitive. For instance, for me at the time, why I quit my job videos were pretty highly competitive. A lot of people were posting them. I decided to niche down so that I could stand out. So instead of just titling the video, why I quit my job, I did why I quit my corporate job so that I was specific. And then in parentheses, I wrote for millennials so that it was also specific. And this video actually took off on my channel. Now, obviously it doesn't have millions and millions of views like some of my other videos. At the time, for a really small channel, this video did really well. And I think that a big reason is because I did choose to niche down. So that's just a little hack for you guys if you are interested in starting a YouTube channel. But anyways, let's watch the video together. What is up, everyone? Welcome back to my channel. If you are new here, my name is Vanessa Lau from VanessaLau.co, and the deal here is that every Wednesday I like to post personal development videos and videos on mindset hacking so that I can help you become more motivated to live a happier and more fulfilling life. So as you can see, when I was starting my channel, I didn't have a super defined niche. I just kind of had a blanket statement of me doing mindset hacking and personal development because that's what I was genuinely interested in before. And my tip to you guys is that just start your channel, okay? Don't overthink the niche so much because the niche is actually gonna find you eventually. So even though I started with mindset videos, over time I realized, wow, I actually, you know, this video did really well, and so I'm gonna talk more about quit the 9-to-5 stuff. And then afterwards, as I started working with people and talking to people one-on-one and helping them, I learned that I was actually pretty good at social media. Then I started talking about social media. And then once I started making money, I started talking about business. And so my niche evolved as my experience grew. And so the worst thing that you can do is not take any action, not do any videos, not do anything, because you're so hyper-focused on the niche. And so don't let that hold you back. So that's just my 2 cents here. Because as you can see, I had an interesting start to my channel. Today's video is a little bit more challenging to create. It's the reason why I left my corporate job. And deep down inside, when I started my YouTube channel, I knew that this was probably the video that I should have posted first. But because it's such a taboo topic, I really held it off. And I was worried mostly about what my old colleagues and my old managers would think and what my old company would think, because I truly respect and really loved actually working with every single person in that company. So I really didn't want to come off as ungrateful. Here's another thing that maybe some of you content creators can resonate with, is the fact that when you're starting out your channel or when you start out being a content creator, your first few videos are going to be pretty nerve-wracking because you always feel like you are creating content almost for your friends and family. And so you care a lot about their opinion, and sometimes that holds you back in the type of content you want to create, or it might cause you to over-explain in your videos, which is what I'm doing here. But at the time, I was in the mindset of, okay, well, everyone who watches my videos knows me in real life, and so I don't want to offend anyone. I don't want, you know, people to be mad at me, and so that kind of made me very uncomfortable to even post about this topic. Now, fast forward 3 years later today, I could care less, because most people who follow me on the internet and watch my videos don't actually know me in real life. But at the time when you're starting out, it can be pretty scary to share stories like this, because you can almost guarantee that almost everyone that's watching the video, at least in the initial stages, are gonna be people who know you in real life. So oftentimes it's easier to create content for strangers than it is to create content for your friends and family.
Well, especially when you leave a job, it's a very personal decision, and it's not a decision that you necessarily, like, I guess what I'm trying to say is, just because I left my job doesn't mean you should leave your job, right? So I just didn't want to, I don't know, add, what's that term? Add fuel to the flame or something like that. So that's why I really held off posting it and creating it in general. But what I realized is that when I did kind of started opening up a little bit as to why I left, or the fact that I did leave, my DMs and my inboxes have just been blowing up almost every day from people who really want to understand why I left. So
this goes back to the friends and family thing. What I realized is that when I decided that I wanted to be a content creator, I quit my job and I started to really shift my Instagram account to be more like influencer style. So me trying to like create content and taking it seriously. I got so many DMs from my friends back from school or my ex-colleagues that would just ask me why I quit my corporate job, because I was already sharing stories of why I quit over on my Instagram. I hadn't necessarily created a YouTube video yet, but it's true that a lot of people in my circle started to really ask me questions. And at the time, that really inspired me to want to create this video. It almost felt like I was taking one for the team, because whenever I talk to my friends, all of them, many of them hated their corporate jobs too, or they weren't having a good time. And all of them struggled to find resources or find connection and all of that. And so I was like, you know what? If everyone is struggling with this, I might as well just share my story on the internet and take one for the team. And that's kind of what I did here. And it was really inspired by the people who just privately messaged me saying, oh my gosh, thank you for letting me know that you even quit your corporate job. That just shows me that like I shouldn't be as afraid to quit. And so that's what truly inspired me to start creating content for the masses about this specific topic.
So I thought, okay, you know what? I think it's time to make a video. But on top of that, I think that when you leave your job, or just the topic of leaving your job is so taboo that it can be pretty lonely and pretty scary when you are trying to figure out if this is the right decision for you. I know that I would have really appreciated a video like this just for the purpose of connecting with someone, because when someone wants to leave their job, they're not gonna go around and telling the whole world, I'm planning on leaving, blah, blah, this is why. It's not until they actually leave where they maybe start talking about it more, but even then it's a little bit uncomfortable.
And that is exactly also why I niched down this video for millennials specifically, because I know even for me, when I was deciding whether or not I even should quit my corporate job, I was on podcasts, YouTube, everywhere trying to look for stories similar to my own. And what I found was that I couldn't necessarily find a lot of people that I could resonate with, because some people that quit their jobs, they didn't have a similar background to me, or they didn't have a similar job to me. It wasn't very niche down to corporate life. It was just like quitting a job in general, like maybe, you know, someone who worked at a fast food chain and decided to quit that job, or someone who decided to quit their teaching job or whatever. I really wanted to find stories of people who are working in corporate, working at the head office level or whatever else. And so that's why I created this video. And I think that it really paid off, and it really started resonating with so many people that were looking for this specific story.
Also, I thought that if this video can make you feel less alone, or it can really help you at least organize all those thoughts that are going through your mind, then I thought, why not? I think that if I can help someone through this, then I think it's worth posting. The structure of this video is gonna be more.
A note here is, back then I edited all my videos, and I had this annoying editing habit where I would cut any type of pause in between my words. And so you'll notice throughout this video that it's very choppy as a result. And I actually got a lot of complaints in this video. People hated that type of editing at the time. And now looking at this video, I totally understand why.
It can be more like a story time, but I definitely think that you should stick around until the end because near the end of the video, I'm probably going to dive in more into the actual like brain exercises and like questions that I asked to really narrow down why leaving my job was the right decision for me. Before we jump into the video, I also want to put a side note out there that this was my personal decision and it doesn't have to be yours. Everyone has their own reasons for why they leave a job. So just keep in mind that this video is very personal to me and it's not the magic formula that you have to follow to figure out if your job is right for you. Before I dive in,
I literally used a barking transition. And I think that's so funny. But yes, I was like putting disclaimers everywhere. I still do whenever I share the journey or the story of why I quit my 9-to-5 is you always have to factor in like other people's privileges or other people's backgrounds and everything like that. So whenever you watch videos or you watch or you listen to stories of why people quit their 9-to-5, just remember to take it with a grain of salt and remember that their experience is still different from yours. And you have to really factor in, are you actually ready to quit your 9-to-5, especially if it's gonna be cold turkey, because not everyone has the privilege to be able to do that. And so that's one thing that's very important to remember.
Into the meat of the video, which is the why I left, I think it's really important for me to at least give a little bit of detail as to where I come from and my background. So I graduated 2 years ago from a very competitive business school, which made you associate success to finding internships and full-time offers at big corporate companies. So of course, being the keener that I was in first and second year, I had already started to narrow down which corporate company that I wanted to work with. By the end of that exercise of narrowing down which company was best for me, I decided that I wanted to work for this Fortune 500 that's in the beauty industry. And it's one of those companies that I think any girl, whether they're in business or not, would die to work for. And so
It was L'Oreal. And I was obsessed with wanting to work at that company because it was about makeup and beauty. And at the time, that was like my jam. You can even tell in this video, I wore a lot of makeup. It was one of my biggest passions. It isn't as much anymore, but that's kind of why that was like the it company that I wanted to work
at. So in second year, I think beginning of second year, the moment I set my sights on this company was the moment that I just went full-fledged keener. Everything that I did, whether it was doing a lot of extracurriculars, taking a bunch of internships, and just working my ass off, was all for the goal of getting a full-time offer at this company eventually. So fast forward a couple more years and my hard work finally paid off and I got the full-time offer. When I got the full-time offer before I graduated, I was just so happy, my ego felt really nice, and it was just comforting to know that I didn't have to scramble in my last year of university to find a full-time job after.
And then, word, like when you go to a business school, the top priority is for you to get a job, right? At least the business school that I went. And so it was really competitive because there was more students and there was more people than there were job opportunities. And so even though I wouldn't necessarily go back to working at a 9-to-5 or I wouldn't necessarily go back working at that company, I still cherish the moment where I did get that full-time offer because I had worked so hard for it. And it was kind of like a badge of honor almost. And so it was a wild time in university of just, yeah, I felt like the Hunger Games for jobs basically.
Then fast forward again a couple months later when I finally started my first day at this job. And keep in mind that, you know, I had pictured this first day at my first full-time job for like years up to this point. I expected fireworks. I expected to feel like I finally made it. But then I guess after a while when you work full-time, you start to kind of look around you and you're like,
I love that editing.
This is it. Okay. Seriously, I really tried to brush that feeling off a lot because I knew deep down that it's really naive to think that your first job or your first few months on the job is going to be sunshine and rainbows. And keeping in mind that success takes time and it's really dumb for you to expect it to be fireworks right away. So I kept going. And as I kept going, I just kept telling myself, okay, once I hit the next position or once I get to the next level, then I'll be happy. But the truth is that position after position, I just found myself in a situation where I still wasn't happy.
So let me get this straight. That feeling does not change whether you're in a corporate job or whether you decide to start your own business. I'm gonna tell you that right now because the way that I'm explaining it is it sounds like it's very unique to this job or unique to corporate, but it's not. Like after I started this business, it's the same thing. You want 1,000 subscribers and then you're like, oh wait, no, I want 50,000. Then I want 100,000. Same thing goes for money. You sign your first paid client, then you want 5 more, then you want to hit a 10K month, then you want to hit 100K, then a million, then you want to hit 8 figures. You're never really going to be happy. And one of my favorite quotes that I keep in mind of is happiness is a choice, not a circumstance. And for the longest time, and even to this day, I often attribute happiness to something that has to happen in order for me to get it. And even at this level, building a multiple 7-figure company, this feeling does not go away. And so you'll never be happy until you truly stay present and you truly just feel happy with what you have today.
And truthfully, again, I kept a lot of that to myself because one, I didn't want to come off as ungrateful because I was very grateful. And number two, I didn't want to come off as impatient. But most importantly, what I also kept telling myself is that, Vanessa, you are still young. You are only X months into the job. You still have a lot to learn. And that was extremely true. I did have a lot to learn. And that's why I just kept going with it. But then eventually, I kind of just hit a point where over a year had passed and my situation didn't really get better, and in a way it kind of just got worse, and I found myself feeling pretty miserable and pretty frustrated, not just with the job but with myself. And when I was frustrated, I would literally cry and just ask myself, why is it so hard for me to get out of bed? Why do I dread going to work? Why do I feel so forced to do work that I really am not excited about? Why do I feel so drained all the time? Looking back, I think that I just didn't really want to admit that job and the company just wasn't for me. I felt like...
Okay, so this is what I want to say that's different from what I'm saying in the video as like an update 3 years later. And that is, yeah, it could have been the job and it could have been the company, but I think that I need to take more responsibility that it was mostly my problem. And what I mean by that is, you know, I think a common mistake is when you are in university or college or whatever else, you don't really necessarily learn about how to set boundaries. If anything, you learn to just forget about your boundaries and just like try to study your ass off, try to do as many things as you can in order to succeed. And then you succeed because you've worked your butt off. And so you get conditioned thinking that you need to work hard in order to be rewarded. And so my issue at the time that I didn't even realize was my issue was that I didn't have clear boundaries. I never asked for help. I never asked my manager to help me reprioritize my work. I never spoke up. And I just kind of like took on everything because I wanted to prove myself. And obviously, if you do that for long periods of time, you burn out. You start feeling resentful. You get unhappy. But I genuinely feel like back then I didn't make a solid attempt in fixing the way that I communicate and the way that I manage my work. And so that's on me. And that's one thing that I'm noticing in this video is that I'm blaming it a lot on the company, but it was really me.
Felt like I kind of went through like an identity crisis because for 4 years in university, I tied my identity and I tied my self-worth into getting this job. And I worked my ass off to get this job. So it just didn't make sense to me that it wasn't clicking. And I think another thing that added to me feeling so frustrated and just so filled with anxiety was because I wasn't bad at my job either. And I had a lot of people that were supporting me, whether it was colleagues, whether it was my managers, and the last thing that I wanted to do was let anyone down. And for many months, it was really hard for me because I just felt so lost. I felt like my definition of success was really tied to this company. And I was so scared that if I quit, then what does that mean? It means that I'm a failure because everyone else in university and society, and to an extent, tells you that you need to have a secure job at a really fancy company in order to be considered a success. And so I just felt so conflicted because my heart was telling me one thing, but my mind was telling me another. But
I also feel like it's a projection. So because I personally at the time would think that if other people quit their jobs or if other people quit anything, that means they're a failure. I automatically thought that that's what people thought of me. So most times these fears that I had were just me projecting what I thought of other people. Now I don't think this at all. Now whenever someone tells me they've quit something, I'm like, oh my gosh, I'm so happy for you because now you're creating space to do something else and you are like really taking ownership of your life and of your business and of whatever else. Like, now I don't think that at all. But back then, I was really in the mindset of, oh, you quit? Wow, what does that say about you? And so that kind of made me very self-conscious when I decided to quit. So it's very interesting when you see those dynamics in play. Another thing too is at the time, like, I was a workaholic. And I mean, sometimes I still can be. But at the time, if other people left at 5 p.m. on a work day, I would be like, wow, they're not putting in the work. Even though they've worked the full 8 hours and they were efficient, I would always associate working more hours as to being successful. And so this is kind of like my mindset back then. And I think that's why the corporate environment was so hard for me to find work-life balance in.
But then eventually what happened, months had passed by and I was just sick of my own shit. Like, seriously, I was sick of myself because I looked in the mirror and I just realized that I became those people who I hate. People who just complain and don't do anything to fix their situation. And that's when I knew, holy shit, I need to do something about this. I need to stop complaining and try to get myself out of this rut. So before I actually left my job, I did try to make my situation better because I'm a firm believer that you need to narrow down exactly what makes you upset.
I agree with that.
Think that it's right to automatically think, okay, shit is hard, I'm gonna quit. I think it's important to say, okay, shit is hard, but why is it hard? Let me first try to find solutions to this problem. And if those solutions don't work, then maybe that's when you consider to leave your job.
I love that I said that. I really do. And that's something I still stand by to this day. Maybe not necessarily in this context, but in when I talk about business strategy, I always say, okay, well, ask, like, if something didn't work, if a strategy didn't work in your social media plan or your business plan, just ask yourself, why didn't it work? Collect the data. Luckily, when you talk about strategy, it's easier to collect the data. But here, it's like, you know, really spend some time journaling, reflecting on what exactly is wrong. Because if you don't actually reflect on what's wrong and you decide to join another job or take another position, the problems don't really go away unless you identify the root cause of it.
Anyways, I ended up mustering the courage to book an appointment with my contact at the HR department in the company. And I essentially told them how I felt. I was pretty transparent to a degree of my feelings and the fact that I was very unhappy working at the company. And I wanted to work with them to find a solution on how they can help me. And what ended up happening is I ended up switching teams and I also ended up switching to a role that had way more responsibility than what I was doing. I was extremely proud of myself for making that stride.
Sorry, I just find it so ironic because it's like, at the time I was struggling with my workload, I was burnt out, and so I asked for another position that would give me a nicer title, but more responsibility. So it's no surprise as to why that didn't work out, because even though in this video I say, oh, find out the root cause of what's causing like the distraughtness, I didn't actually figure out what the root cause was. And instead, I solved the wrong problem thinking that I just needed a promotion or that I needed a new manager or that I needed another team to work on. And I got what I wanted, but the problems didn't go away. In fact, it actually got worse, which led to me quitting my job like a few months after even getting that promotion. So you see how not understanding what's truly wrong is a problem? Yeah.
I had to raise my hand and literally be like, help me, I need help with this. And I was very, very happy that the company did help me.
No,
so if
girl.
You're in a situation where you aren't really sure why you're upset, I highly recommend that you at least reach out to someone.
No. I thought that them helping me was giving me the promotion or giving me a title change, which is what I thought I needed. But what I truly needed help on was strategies to help me prioritize, strategies to effectively communicate and set boundaries and understand what's important, what's not important, getting feedback. Like, those are the things that probably would have helped me, getting more advice on how to integrate work-life balance. Those would have maybe made me last longer in corporate, but it wasn't the title change that I needed. It wasn't more responsibility that I needed.
Whether that's your manager, whether that's someone from HR, to ask them what they think and ask them if they can help you. Because at the end of the day, you want to leave knowing that you tried your very best to make your situation work. So at that point, another month had passed and I found myself with a new problem. And my new problem was that even with this sexier role, I still wasn't happy.
No,
and
no
that's
shit.
Essentially where I realized that it didn't matter if I had a different team, it didn't matter if I had a different brand, it didn't matter if I had different job responsibilities. I think what it kind of boiled down to was that I just didn't like working in a corporate environment.
No.
And I just didn't really like the job that I was doing.
No. Don't listen to me. I really don't think it was the corporate environment. Yes, now that I understand myself, now that I have my own business, like I love entrepreneurship and I feel like I always loved being a leader and I loved, you know, taking ownership of things, specifically taking really small things and like being able to blow them up. I have a track record, you can check my LinkedIn, of extracurriculars that I did in university, running clubs, doing all those things that were quite entrepreneurial. So I do understand that like entrepreneurship is a really good fit for me. But the reason why I'm saying no is I still haven't understood what the true problem was, and that was my own working habits that were toxic. And I needed to recondition the way that I was working. That's what I needed. But here in this video, I'm saying, oh yeah, I wasn't the team, it wasn't the sexy title, it was because of corporate. It was because of the corporate environment. No. I mean, it could have been. It could have been the culture, absolutely. I don't think it's like 100% on me, but I do think that in this video, I need to take more ownership of what I could have done better and what I could have changed in my behavior in order to make my situation better. And I'm not seeing that I'm taking ownership of that.
In general, and that's okay to feel that way. And for so long, I felt ashamed of that. But what I realized is that when you graduate from university, do you really know what you're going into? No, and I think that life is all about testing and learning. And so what happened with me is I tested this job for almost 2 years, and then I realized and I learned that it wasn't for me. And I had to be okay with that. Going back to why I didn't like my job, I think a really big reason was that I just didn't feel fulfilled. And I know that a good percentage of people that are going to be watching this video is going to say, oh, you're so naive, not every job that you have is going to be fulfilling. That's great, that's what you think. But for me, when I look back at my university experience, I had a jam-packed schedule and I was working my ass off. And to put this into context, at one point in my last year of university, in order to graduate fast enough so that I could work full-time right after, I had a maxed out workload for both terms. I was working 2 part-time jobs, 1 in the morning and 1 at night.
Crazy.
And I was also president of the entire student society. I was doing a lot of work, but not once did that really feel like work. I was so happy to do it.
That is true though. That is really true. It's actually funny because like a few weeks ago I was looking at my old emails and I saw all the emails I was sending back and forth back then when I was running like different clubs and I was like, you know, doing all these extracurriculars in university. And I was like, wow, like I put in a lot of work in university. I was really passionate about what I was doing. And I feel the same way about my business today, which is why I'm really grateful and happy that I've created something for myself that works for me. And yeah, like I encourage you guys to think about that too. Think about all the times in your life in the past where, you know, work didn't always feel like work. Now, obviously, even to this day, there are some parts of my business where I'm like, oh my God, I don't want to do this. Like, nothing is ever going to be 100% fulfilling, I would say, even to this day. But I do encourage you guys, if you're watching this video and you're feeling lost yourself, is to really identify the moments in time where time just flew by and you're like, whoa, I didn't even realize I put in so much work, or I didn't even realize that I did so much. Those are the moments where you really want to tap into to see what your strengths are.
Whereas when I contrast it and compare with my job at the corporate company, everything I did just felt like hard work that I didn't want to do. And it was very exhausting for me. And when I think back about the times where I worked really hard but it didn't feel like work, it made me realize that loving what you do is possible. So then
there is a quote that I love, and it's from Naval, and I've posted it on my Instagram before, I've shared it before, and that is, when you're able to find a career where work feels like play, you have unlocked the key to life. You know, because a lot of times the way that you can get a competitive advantage over everyone else, the way that you can unlock true success, is when you choose a career or something that you do where to you it feels like genuine play. That way no one can compete with you on it, because if person B tries to do the same thing that you're doing, but they're not passionate about what they're doing, or you know, that whatever they're doing is hard for them, they're never gonna be able to get to the level that you're at. And so always try to find things in your life, what career-wise, that truly just time just passes by and it comes easy to you. Now, obviously not everything comes easy, but it's overall like something that you can get lost in. Those are really the sweet spot of finding a career that gives you some longevity for sure.
And I asked myself, okay, so why don't I love what I'm doing at this corporate job? And I think the real answer is that I just didn't have clarity as to my life's future. Because when I compare it back to the times where I worked really hard in university, all of my actions were 100% aligned with my goal. And my goal at the time was to get this job. It was to get a full-time job after graduating. And so that's why all of the hard work that I did, it made sense. And my purpose was so big and so exciting that working hard during university just never felt like work.
I would also add, I think that the work that I did in my extracurriculars were just like really fun for me. Being able to manage a club, hiring people, leading people, doing speaking events, like those were things that I still did in university. So it's really interesting because the career that I have now is very similar to the same things that I did back then in university. And so it's kind of like a full circle moment of how this is a perfect match for me career-wise. And so I'm just sharing that. I don't know why I'm sharing that, but anyways, just sharing.
It just felt like I was fulfilling a purpose that was bigger than myself. So with that nugget of wisdom, I then proceeded to do the following 3 exercises that ultimately led me to finally take the plunge and quit
my job.
All
right, let's see what these exercises are.
The first exercise that I did is I asked myself, what exactly is my life vision? What do I...
I feel like even now, 3.5 years later, I still struggle with knowing what my life vision is. So take life vision, take like 10-year plans, 5-year plans with a grain of salt. I think it's complete BS when I hear someone and they're like, I figured out my 5-year vision. Like things always change in life. I think it's good to have direction, but don't put too much of your, don't put too much pressure on yourself to have like a vision.
Who I want for myself, and is what I'm doing today 100% or at least 80% aligned with what I want in my life? I used an arbitrary number, like
I still don't know what I want in my life.
The age 30, and I asked myself, okay, by 30, what type of lifestyle do I want to have? Where do I want to work? What do I want to be doing every day? What are my day-to-day tasks? And what I realized that what I was doing at my job just seriously was not aligned with my big vision. Second big question that I asked myself,
I'm turning 28 next year. When I filmed this video, I was like, what, 24? So very cool to hear me say, by the time I'm 30, I want this, this, this. And it's cool because I do feel like I'm living that life and I'm not even 30 yet. Like, look at this place that I'm in. Like when I started this video, when I filmed it, I was sitting on the floor in my childhood bedroom at my mom's house. I like redecorated it so at least it felt like more mature. And fast forward to today, like I'm in this house that I bought this year with my own money, thanks to me taking the leap of faith. So I think it's really cool just to hear all this coming from myself. But anyways, back to what I was saying, yes, I think it's unrealistic to think that you're gonna map out a full 10-year vision for yourself. But I do agree with what I'm saying is like, with the information that you have now, ask yourself like, what would you like to do every day? If you could design a dream job description for yourself, what would it look like? And I guarantee you, even if at the time that you write your dream job description, it sounds very absurd, really out there, I can almost guarantee that it is possible. The fact that I'm just filming a video for you guys right now wearing like a sweatsuit and just watching YouTube videos is beyond me, right?
Was, do I want my boss's job, or is there anyone in this company that I envy being? And for me personally, my answer was a hard no. And even though I have an immense amount of respect for every single person that I...
And this is me again being scared that people who were watching my videos were my friends and family and coworkers, that they were gonna get mad at me, me like over explaining again and trying to praise them.
Worked with, I just realized that I didn't want their job. So why would I be staying at a company where I didn't see a future in? What it also boils down to is I didn't have a why. I didn't have internal motivation. And that's why I felt very frustrated and I felt very stuck doing things that I was...
Yeah, I think that's valid. I think that, you know, when I said that having a vision might be a bit harder, I think having a mission is a little bit easier, and trying to create a career for yourself that aligns with your mission, or finding a career for yourself that aligns with that mission, is a lot easier. So for example, with the YouTube channel, when I started, my big why, like I mentioned earlier on in this video, was I just wanted to share my story of leaving the 9-to-5 so that other people who were facing similar things that I did didn't have to feel alone. And that was kind of my North Star at the time and why I pushed through creating videos, even though I didn't have a lot of subscribers at the time, I didn't have a lot of views that I have, the same type of views that I have today. That was my why. I just really wanted to help people. And that just made entrepreneurship a lot easier. So when you go into entrepreneurship, just assuming that you're gonna make a bunch of money, if you're very like money focused, it's a bit harder to be consistent and it's a bit harder to show up for everyone else. Versus when you have a purpose, a why, a mission, it then becomes a lot easier. And eventually, if you decide to grow your team also needs to understand that vision too. You need to have this culture where people are behind your mission and are willing to work for that mission. And so I think that's really important in life, regardless if you decide to start a business or if you decide to join another corporate company.
I was doing because I didn't have a reason why, which isn't a good thing, because I personally believe that if you're going to be spending 70% of your time, if not more, at your job, you should at least really enjoy it. So after I realized that I didn't exactly have a why that was aligned with what I was doing at that job, the last thing that I did is I did a risk assessment.
The risk assessment is bomb. This is probably the best activity that I did. This was the activity that made me realize, okay, I'm ready to quit my job.
Assessment. I wanted to see how risk tolerant I actually was. And I think that this was probably one of the most important exercises that I did before I finally called it quits. And so what I essentially did, and what I would recommend anyone to do before they pull the plug, is to actually physically write down every single thing that you can think of that could go wrong in one column. And then in the next column right beside it, write down your solution. Solutions. Write down how you're going to solve that problem. For me, what I realized when I was doing this exercise is that I had a solution for every single thing that could go wrong, which made me realize that I was in a very good position to lead.
So this goes back to the whole thing I talked about regarding, you know, making sure that you assess whether or not you have the means to even quit your 9-to-5. And when I did this assessment in one column, I was like, okay, well, if I can't find a place to live, what am I gonna do? Okay, move back to my mom's house. If I don't have enough money for this, what am I gonna do? Okay, I can do this. And so I listed all of my fears, and then I listed all of the actions that I would take. And it was very obvious for me that I was privileged enough to actually quit cold turkey. But for a lot of people, you might have debt. You may not have a good relationship with your parents to be able to call them up and be like, hey, can I crash back at my childhood bedroom? Not everyone has that luxury, and I think it's very important to do your own assessment on whether or not you can actually afford to leave your job cold turkey, at least.
Even though I didn't have that much money saved up, nor did I have a concrete backup plan, for me, doing that exercise was enough for me to realize that I'm in a good position compared to a lot of people. What this exercise also made me realize is that I'm extremely privileged, because not a lot of people can just leave their jobs and go back to live with their parents. A lot of people can be on their visas. A lot of people could have their parents in a different country. A lot of people could have a mortgage. They could have kids. So what I realized too at that point was that, damn, I'm still very young. My risk tolerance is very high. And so I would be doing myself a huge disservice if I wasn't spending my time doing things that are more aligned with my bigger purpose.
I agree. One of my biggest advice is, while you're young, take as many risks as you can, because you have so much time to be able to recuperate whatever you lose from taking those risks. There's a really amazing video by Alex Becker. I'm gonna link it somewhere in this video. And it really, really highlights why taking risks or doing certain things in your 20s and like 30s is going to be very beneficial as you get older. So he just really breaks down some of the things that young people should really take advantage of while they're still young. So I highly recommend, after watching this video, you watch Alex Becker's video, because it is amazing.
Because not a lot of people have the luxury to do that. And that is when I knew that leaving was the right decision for me. On top of that, my definition for risk completely changed as well. You know, back then, I thought that leaving my job would be really risky. But in doing these exercises, I found that staying at my job was riskier. Because when I'm staying at my 100%. Job doing things that don't light me up, I am actually taking time away from...
Opportunity cost. This is called opportunity cost.
Me actually finding something that I enjoy doing wholeheartedly. And that's why it became very clear to me that I needed to leave. I needed to leave to take time off to pursue my dreams. And one of my dreams is to be an entrepreneur. But that also doesn't mean that I am set in stone with that dream. Because what I want to also share with you is that it's okay to change your mind. We're raised to think that quitting is such a bad thing. It's not. Yes, I agree that you shouldn't quit something just because it's hard. But I also think that you shouldn't be wasting your time on something that doesn't serve you.
Alex Becker says this in his video, but when you're young, time is your biggest asset. When you get older, money is your biggest asset, not your time, because when you get older, you don't have a lot of time left. And so time becomes more scarce as you get older. When you're young, money may be a little bit more scarce, but you have a lot of time. And so you want to take advantage of that time. You want to start businesses. You want to take risks. You want to invest. You want to do all these things that you can because you are in a great position to do so and you have a lot of time to make it up. And you also have a lot of time for those things, those seeds that you plant earlier to compound. And so, you know, I think that this video is really perfect for young people who maybe are a little bit less risk-taking to really change your mind about that.
I don't think that you should be wasting your time on something where you can't connect the dots to your bigger vision, to your dream. So for me, even though right now I am experimenting with entrepreneurship, that's not to say that I'm going to be an entrepreneur for the rest of my life, because you know what? I've never been an entrepreneur. The same way how you have never worked a full-time corporate job. So that's why you have to forgive yourself when things don't work out the way you think they're gonna work out. Because life is all about testing and learning. You have to test things in order to learn from them in order to come to your own conclusions as to whether it is right for you or not.
100% agree. I think that the biggest mistake a lot of newer entrepreneurs, newer content creators make is they get so stuck in analysis paralysis because they think that whatever they choose is going to solidify their destiny, when in fact, it's really the action that you take that's going to lead you to your destiny. And so, you know, I completely agree with what I'm saying in this video.
That being said, don't feel like you're gonna be a failure or a quitter just because you leave your job. Because if you don't do these things and if you don't experiment, especially when you are in your 20s, then you're gonna wake up regretting. And for all that time that you were upset with your job or that you were feeling so drained or that you were feeling so unfulfilled, you could have spent that time actually taking massive action to find something that is more aligned with who you are as a person and things.
Overall, you just have more time to figure it out, and you should take that time to figure it out and take that time to talk to people, take the time to experiment with things, try new things when you're young. You know, I think that just be very, very mindful of the time that you have. And if you're feeling lost right now, I think it's okay to kind of feel stuck, but I think it's not okay to feel stuck and not do anything about it other than complain, because time is just, you know, you're losing time every single day.
Things that truly light you up and make you happy, because you only have one shot in this life, so why not make it a happy one? Another thing that I actually have to add, remember that you are the driver of your life. If you don't like the direction that you're going, then steer the fucking wheel. Whether it's a small turn, like going to your HR department and telling them straight up, hey, listen, I don't like the situation that I am in. Is there anything that you can do to help me? Or the big turns, the big U-turns, where you up and leave your job and change your entire career path or go traveling for X amount of months, that's on you to decide. It's not on your parents to decide. It's not on your boss to decide. It's on you, because at the end of the day, you live and you die with the decisions that you make in this lifetime. So if you only have one life to live, then you better take control of it.
I think this is really important too, especially if you are a people pleaser or you're someone who really values like authority. That's something that I really struggle with. I think with my Asian upbringing is anyone who is like above me, whether that's like my parents or my boss or my manager, I really, really don't want to disappoint those people. I really like am careful with how I interact with those type of people. And so I think it's important that I said this because it's just your permission slip to realize that, like, at the end of the day, doesn't matter what your boss says, doesn't matter what your family says, doesn't matter what whoever says, this is your life at the end of the day. And, you know, at the heart of it, you're gonna be responsible for whatever comes out of your life. And so, yeah, agree.
Because what ends up happening is that life will happen to you instead of for you. So With that being said, that's the end of the video. I hope you enjoyed it. And so if you actually want more videos surrounding this topic, then definitely don't hesitate to thumbs up this video so that I get the message. Because again, there's a lot of things that I can talk about. There's a lot of things that happen after you quit your job. You know, there's a lot of lessons that I've also learned as well. So if this is something that you're interested in, please thumbs up the video so that I know. And also make sure to subscribe if you want to see my content. So with that being said, wishing you best of luck, and I hope you have a great day. See ya.
That was a cute video. I think I was also very smart because at the time I didn't really like have a solidified business. I was just saying I wanted to be an entrepreneur and I wanted to share mindset lessons and all these things. But I think what was really good was in my end card right here, I've got my website. I made sure I had my website up and running, or at least something. I remember at the time I didn't have a full-blown website. I had like a mailing list though. So it was just a landing page that said VanessaLau.co under construction, but leave your email here to get mindset tips when it's ready or something. So I already was starting to collect emails. I put in my Instagram, all of my socials. I think that this is really well done, especially for someone who did not know what they were doing. And you know, with YouTube, your videos stay there for a long time. So even 3 years later, if someone's watching this video, they're still gonna find my Instagram. So that's my tip for you guys, if you guys are creating videos, is make sure you link all your socials from the get-go. But anyways, beyond just like social media tips, I'm always thinking about that. I really liked that video, and I think that there's a lot of like things that I said in my reaction that are just updates to my thoughts, and a lot of things of me just like reinforcing the things that I said back then. And so a thumbs up if you like this video. If you want me to react to more videos or talk about, you know, 9-to-5 stuff, corporate jobs, or just like quitting in general, let me know in the comment section below. But I hope you enjoyed watching that video with me, hearing my reaction to it. And yeah, I post a lot of videos on marketing, entrepreneurship, social media. So while you wait for next week's video, make sure you check out these two videos that I have right here as well. I promise they will not disappoint. As always, guys, I appreciate you. I hope you guys have a great day, a great week, and a great life. Thanks for tuning in, and I will see you in the next one. Bye, guys.